Students, in this lecture, we are going to learn about the construction and working of the Ruby laser. Now, Ruby laser was the first laser to be practically made. Okay. Now, what is Ruby? Ruby is, we know it's a precious stone which is pinkish red in color. Now, the chemical composition of Ruby is aluminium oxide. It's basically aluminium oxide, Al2O3, with about 0.05% of chromium atoms in it. So, chromium is like an impurity in aluminium oxide. Now, pure aluminium oxide, Al2O3, without any chromium, is not ruby. It doesn't have any color, it's not precious. Okay, but when little amount of chromium is added to this aluminium oxide, we get ruby. So, ruby is basically aluminium oxide doped with chromium atoms. Now, in the ruby laser, a ruby rod, this is what you see here in the middle here. This is a ruby rod, about 5 centimeters in length and 1 centimeter in diameter. Now, the ends of the rod are made exactly flat, parallel to each other, and they are silvered. They are polished and made, silver coating is applied to them so that they behave like mirrors. Now, what are these mirrors? These are the mirrors of the optical resonator. You remember the optical resonator? It consists of two plane parallel mirrors. One is a 50% reflecting mirror, other one is a 100% reflecting mirror. And we had seen why the optical resonator is an important component of every laser system. So here also, the ruby rod, the end faces of it are silvered such that one face becomes 50% reflecting and the other surface becomes 100% reflecting. Next, this ruby rod is enclosed in a quartz tube, through which a coolant is circulated. Coolant goes in through this opening and the coolant comes out through this opening. So, coolant is circulated through the ruby rod because we will see later on a lot of heat is generated when the laser is generating laser light. Okay, so this heat has to be taken out, otherwise the ruby rod may melt, the full system may melt. So, we require to cool the system using a coolant. Then, a xenon lamp is coiled around this entire setup. Okay, now what is a xenon lamp? It is the same lamp which you will find in a camera flash. It is a very powerful lamp which gives out white light, intense white light, burst of white light when it is powered on by this power source. So, the xenon lamp is coiled around, uniformly coiled around a ruby rod so that when it is powered on, it will give out an intense burst of white light. So, ruby laser uses optical pumping. It takes up the energy from the xenon lamp for the process of pumping. Now, this ruby laser gives out, now the laser light comes out from the 50% reflecting mirror because this 50% mirror will allow some photons to come out and remaining part will be reflected back for the process of amplification to continue. So, the laser output of the ruby laser, it gives out a red color laser light having wavelength 6943 Armstrong units. Okay, so now, how does the ruby laser work? What is the working of the ruby laser? The ruby laser uses a three-level pumping scheme. Okay, so it functions based on a three-level pumping scheme. So, if you see the energy level diagram of chromium, now this ruby rod here is the active medium. Light amplification laser occurs in this medium, but all the atoms in this ruby rod don't take part in the laser. So, which are the different types of atoms in ruby? There is aluminium, there is oxygen, and there is chromium. But it is only the chromium atoms, or rather the chromium ions in this ruby laser, which actually take part in the laser, which actually do the work of light amplification, because it is only the chromium ions which have a metastable state in it. And we have seen earlier that metastable state is required for the laser generation, for light amplification. At least one metastable is compulsory to be there. Okay, so it's only chromium which has the metastable state. So chromium atoms in ruby act like the active centers. Out of all the three atoms, aluminum, oxygen and chromium, it is only the chromium which does the light amplification. So, chromium are called as the active centers in the ruby laser. Now, this is the energy level diagram of chromium. E1 in it is the ground state, the lowermost state, ground state. Now, there's another state, E2 is a metastable state in it. Atoms can remain in this level for a long time. And right on top, there is a band of levels. Now, E3 is not just one single level, but it is made up of very finely closed energy levels. So, they are so close that we can consider them as one single level. It's called as a band of levels. So, this entire collection of all these finely closed energy levels is called as E3, the uppermost level, the pumping level. Now, When the xenon lamp power is switched on, when it is powered on, it gives out an intense burst of white light. Okay, so xenon lamp gives out an intense burst of white light. Now, this chromium ions in ruby, they take up the green component. Now, white light has all many components, right? It has violet, green, blue, yellow, and other seven colors in it. But only the green component of this white light, which is given out by xenon lamp, is absorbed by the chromium ions. And in the process, the chromium ions from the ground state, they are excited to the energy levels E3, band of energy levels E3. So, through the optical pumping process, because of the xenon lamp light, the chromium atoms from the level E1 go to the level E3. Now, E3 is a normal excited levels. These are not metastable. They cannot remain here for long. So, what happens to them? They either return back to the ground state through spontaneous emission. It is not shown here. So, this is one of the options for them. So, some of the chromium ions will return back to the ground state, but some of them will fall into the metastable state through a non-radiative transition. So, this is typically a three-level pumping scheme working method. So, some of the chromium atoms from E3 will drop into the metastable state through a non-radiative transition. It is a transition in which there is no photon given out. So, the chromium ions which fall into this level E2, they can remain over here for a long time because it is a metastable state. So, the number of atoms in this level E2 keep on increasing because there is a collection of atoms over here. And within a very short duration of time, what will happen? Number of atoms in E2 will become more than that in the ground state E1. So, we will be achieving population inversion between E2 and E1. Now, the xenon lamp is so powerful, it's a so intense lamp, xenon lamp, white color light. It is so powerful that just one burst of xenon lamp is enough to take more than half the ground state atoms and put them into the metastable state. So, with just one flash of the xenon lamp, we are achieving population inversion. Okay, so the number of atoms in E2 will become more than that in E1. Population inversion is achieved between E2 and E1, and then through the first spontaneously emitted photon from E2 to E1, the process of laser starts. So, 2 photons, then 4, then 8 and 16 and so on, and we get an intense burst of laser light coming out from the 50% reflecting mirror, and that is a laser output which is red in color, having a wavelength 6943 Armstrong unit. Okay, so this is how the xenon ruby laser works. With the xenon lamp, the atoms from E1 are taken to E3. From E3, some of them fall in E2. So, number of atoms in E2 keep on increasing because it is a metastable state. Soon, number here will be more than here. Population inversion is achieved. And once population inversion is achieved, the laser light is given out. Okay. Now, ruby laser has three disadvantages. Okay. So, what are the disadvantages or the drawbacks of the ruby laser? The first thing is, it uses a three-level pumping scheme. So, whatever is the drawback of the three-level pumping scheme is the drawback of the ruby laser. Now, what's the drawback there? In the three-level pumping scheme, we had seen earlier that it requires very high pumping power. Okay. So, ruby laser requires a very high pumping power. So, energy of the pumping method has to be very high. And that is why we are using a xenon lamp here. It's a very, very powerful lamp. So, the very high pumping power which is required for the three-level pumping scheme is provided by the xenon lamp. Second disadvantage, drawback of the ruby laser is that its efficiency is very less. Now, why do we say efficiency is less? Because the xenon lamp here, the energy source, is giving out white light. It's a white light source. But does the chromium ion take up the entire energy of the xenon lamp? No. It takes only the green component, whereas the other component like red, yellow, violet and other components are wasted. They're not used at all in the working of the laser, in the energy level diagram. So, right? So, only the green component is used, whereas the remaining component is lost. So, it's about, right, some of the 100 units of energy are there. You're utilizing might be only something around 20 units of energy. So, energy is, efficiency is only 20%. So, very low efficiency because you're not using the entire light from the xenon lamp. And the third drawback of the ruby laser is that its output is not continuous. The output, the laser output which is given here is not continuous. It occurs in the form of short pulses. So, there's a laser output, then laser output stops. Again, another laser pulse is given out and it stops. So, the output is not continuous laser output, but in the form of on and off pulses. Now, why does that happen? It is like this. Now, when the xenon lamp, which is here, it is not continuously on. When the power source is switched on, it requires some time to charge, then it gives out a flash. Once it's fully charged, it gives out a flash, just like a camera flash. It gives out a flash, then again it has to be charged. Now, with every flash of the xenon lamp, population inversion is achieved and laser occurs. But when the laser occurs, atoms from E2 are brought down to the level E1. So, number of atoms in E1 will increase, number of atoms in E2 will decrease. So, as the laser occurs, slowly number of atoms in E2 keep on decreasing, and very soon here number of atoms will become less than over here. And once population inversion state is lost, the laser output stops. Okay, so because of the laser, the population inversion state slowly is lost, and once the population inversion state is lost, the laser output stops. Till when? Again, when will the laser output start again? When population inversion is again achieved. And when does that happen? When the next flash of xenon lamp comes. So when the next flash comes, again huge number of atoms from here are taken up. Population inversion takes place again, and again the laser starts. Then through the laser, atoms are brought down to the level E1, and again population inversion state is lost, laser stops. So this process keeps on continuing. With every flash of the xenon lamp, population inversion is achieved, laser output starts, then again it stops, then with the next flash again it starts. So the output of the ruby laser is not a continuous laser output, but it occurs in the form of short duration pulses. So these are the three drawbacks. It requires very high pumping power, it has very low efficiency, and the output is not continuous but occurs in the form of pulses. Okay, so in the next lecture we'll be studying about a helium neon laser, which is a better laser compared to the ruby laser. Thank you.